So today I'm going to be telling the story of the Lizard Lounge. And if I want to tell the story of the Lizard Lounge, I think sometimes you need to go way back. And I'm going to go way back to my sister's birthday party in, I think it was 8, and I was about 16, I think. Anyway, so the big band at the time was ABBA. And they had a big song at the time, called I Do, I Do, I Do, which was number one. Anyway, the kids were at the party and they put that on, you know, and it's number one, so you think people jump into it, but nothing was happening with I Do, I Do, I Do. But I knew the B-side was a song called Rock Me. So I went over to the record player and I flipped I Do, I Do and put on Rock Me. And all the kids started jumping around. And it got the party started, and it was just, I don't know, but I always remember that because it was like the magic of playing a record and getting people jumping up and down. It was magic. So after that, I don't know if I actually did any DJing at all. A friend of mine used to make all kind of mixtapes, all this 60s stuff. And once I could get my hands on a good cassette player, and then was like a big beatbox, I started making my own mixtapes for the car. But then I joined a band, and so it was a band called The Fiction, and then I started a band called Little Murders. And basically, we'd go to these parties around town, and I would start taking my mixtapes of basically, which was 60s records, to these places, to these parties. Girl, you really got me going. You got me so I don't know what I'm doing. Lots of times it would get taken off. People wanted to listen. Melbourne was becoming a bit more post-punk, so that my ones would actually just go. However, there was a group of us that were becoming what would be called the mod revival. Anyway, so, and we started to get together and have parties where we played the music we liked, and I would try and play my music, and it went a lot better until we started, the friends of mine started a place called Commotion. Now, Commotion was every Wednesday night at the Alfred in Richmond, and I would DJ now and again, but because I was playing in the band and we were often playing on Wednesdays, I didn't get there all the time. But it was great when I went down there, I could get to play a few records, and I love playing records. The same later on, the same guys, or one of the guys at least, opened a place called Venetian Room. And the Venetian Room, again, I got to play now and again. But the band was doing quite well. So, you know, I couldn't do it that much. But every time I played records, it was great. Until comes a time when the band started, you know, falling apart, mind you. It wasn't getting anywhere. It was 1985 or so. And I was doing some DJ at the Venetian Room, and my friend who ran it, Ronnie, and his mate, Michael, they were going to open a new club, and it was called Rubber Soul. Now, Rubber Soul needed a DJ. So Ronnie said to me, listen, you got any records? And I said, records? I got tons of records. I got because I'd been collecting 60s records all along, right from the very start. There was a neighbor who used to give me records all the time, so I had a ton of records. And so I became a DJ every Friday night at a place called Rubber Soul. So I started the Rubber Soul every Friday night. Yeah, it started off good, and then it kind of went a bit quiet and started to pick up a bit, meandering a bit. But then we talked about having what's called a special. And a special is when you just concentrate on one artist. Now, the first artist we did was a band called The Doors. Love me cheap,
time, baby. Love me twice today. Love me two time, girl. I'm gone away.
Boom. Sonny Rubber Soul was huge, right? Lots of people coming to Rubber Soul, lines down the block. Every Friday was just packed out. I was just having the time. And then we opened a place called Glam at a place called Ashley's in Collingwood, which was a Wednesday night. It didn't do too well. But actually, Michael and Ronnie got to talk to the guys at Ashley's and they let them do a Saturday night there. And the Saturday night was called Barbarella's. And that was our first taste of basically lines right around the block. It was packed out. It went from 9 until, I don't know, sometime in the morning, you know, like it was way past. We'd go out for breakfast afterwards. Whereas Rubber Soul was only until midnight, I think, or even 11 o'clock. And we used to go out to other clubs afterwards. So Barbarella's was where we played anything. Anything would go, you know, it just play anything. So I was involved in choosing the music because I did the poster and it basically was just great stuff. You know, if it was good, we play it. It's a formula I probably use later on. Anyway, so we opened another place called Beehive, which is on the riverside in down by the Yarra, which is gone now. That was through the roof too, but the owners said, oh, listen, we're going to open our own one now. Can you just nick off? So in the end, we took Beehive back to Rubber Soul. And, well, which was called the Karen Tavern. I'm jumping ahead there. So we had Rubber Soul on Friday night, Beehive on Saturday night. And then I got this gig DJing at a place called Shout around the corner from the Karen Tavern. So I was Thursday, Friday, Saturday, I was DJing all the time, just, you know, doing lots and lots of work. And then something went, we opened a club called Chaos. Again, at the same time, I'm just a DJ, but I'm helping out with all the promotion and choosing how we do it all. And with Chaos, it was an old club there that used to have Therapy in it. Therapy was a dance club. It was and before that was a band place called Carnaby Inn, which I remember seeing the Sunny Boys there. Chaos went bad. The thing is that with Chaos, they Ronnie and Michael didn't want to go against their own Saturday night. So there's a guy there, Jason, who took over Saturday nights at the Karen Tavern. I think first was, he called it Rave, I think it was. Anyway, Jason was, you know, he used to come to the Beehive all the time. He used to hang around the DJ booth, and I remember the first time he tried to play records, so his fingers were shaking trying to put it on. But he was a really nice guy. And he took over a rave, and I used to pop in sometimes. It was really good. I liked the music he played. They decided to let me go on Friday night, so they said, off you go, you're no longer. Now, the Shout gig on Thursday also was finished. So I went from working a lot, three nights a week, to working nothing. So I was just teaching. And I was playing a bit of music. But then Jason, who was running Rave on Saturday nights, started another club called an alternative club at the Union Hotel in Windsor, at the Union Hotel in Windsor. And when he opened that club, he said to me, listen, do you want Saturday nights at the Union Hotel? You know, you could do something with it. You know, he felt bad because I had been sacked from Rubber Soul. At the same time, he was saying that Rubber Soul, the management at the Karen Tavern, pressed Michael and Ronnie to get me back. They thought it was unfair that I'd been sacked because of mistakes that had been made or whatever. So I got the job back at Rubber Soul, but then I got the job back at, and then I got my own club at the Lizard Lounge. At first, Lizard Lounge didn't really take off. You know, we used to get about 25 people a night, and that's, I did try bands. I was managing a band called Captain Coke, and I got them in. And so the first few months was, I'd get the money and I'd just spend it on more music for the club. So I built up a nice big collection of eclectic music. The specials didn't work there. You know, putting ABBA specials, no good idea. We advertised at first as a kind of Doors type cult venue. But then two things happened which made it quite really big. So I'm over there one day and I get to Chapel Street and Jason White is painting the front window of the bottle shop. And he's painted it all white. I said, you know, this is a Friday afternoon, I think it was. I said, what's going on? He goes, well, John decided to get more people in the club. We're going to have drink specials. And so we had happy hour from 9 to 11. But the second thing that came along was a song. And it was a band from America, and they put out this record. And I first heard it driving my car, and then I thought, God, that's going to sound great at the club. And it was Smells Like Teen Spirit by Nirvana. And then boom. Now, Smells Like Teen Spirit just kind of exploded, and it brought alternative music. I don't know, it got everybody interested. It was just like phenomenal. At the same time, there was cheap drinks. So at the end of 1990, which is when I opened the Lizard Lounge, it went from 25, the next week was 50, and the next week was 75, then there was 200. And for, I remember John coming in one go, and he just couldn't believe it, that we had gone from this nothing. Because of the cheap drinks and because everybody now wanted to go to a place where they played Smells Like Teen Spirit. And when they got there, they heard bands like The Cure and The Smiths. And they loved it, and it just went boom. Lizard Lounge became enormous. So much so, at the end of the year, I said, I quit Rubber Soul on Fridays, and John got me, and I was reluctant, John got me to open a Friday at the Friday night. We called that Revolver, which is like one up from Rubber Soul. A bit stupid, I know. So I got Ronnie from Rubber Soul. And but that didn't work out that well, so we just made it Lizard Lounge, and that took a while to grow, but in the end it did grow big as well, so much that we decided to open Thursdays. And at first, for the first 3 weeks, we charged $5 to get in, and it was just like normal. And then one day we said, it's not working. And then John said, well, don't charge anybody, and he would pay for the DJs. I thought, well, okay then. So we did that, and then Thursdays went massive. So Thursdays was massive. Friday was incredible. Saturdays was massive. It was kind of a rivalry, you know. I was advertising the Thursdays and I was advertising the Saturdays as well and the Fridays. It was really big. During the 90s, from 91 to 2001, for 10 years, the Lizard Lounge was massive all the time. It was, I had to give a teaching then. It was too big. And I started the record label on the proceeds, and, you know, we became a business, and we tried to do another club. That didn't work. They told me that you were really bad news. They said that you were no good for me. They told me that you were up
Yeah, and it was the great times. We had some fantastic times there. It was just loaded up. We got sheets and we hung them up. And I mean, at first we gave out lollies at the door when people came in, and we had sheets. I mean, a lot of these ideas were just taken from other places, of course. But we gave a lot of stuff. And we gave up, we had to give up giving out lollies because we found that some of them they didn't like and they would spit them out and they'd stick to the floor. So the carpet got a bit messed up. We started using fluorescent paints. John didn't mind what we did, really. And then we came across Tank Girl, and that became our kind of icon. And became on the walls and stuff, and I got t-shirts made and posters and stuff. It snowballed, and one of the things that was really good is that a lot of people started coming by themselves. And what that kind of means is, you know, like, they, it was welcoming, it was a pleasant, you know, there was, people felt safe there, and it became, I wouldn't say the word family, but it became a very nice place to go, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. A lot of my friends became, got DJ jobs there, I mean, and my friends became door people. My guitarist Rod's partner was, lots of people worked there, because if I could give him a job there, I could give him a job. And then later on, I'd give him a job at the, helping out people, give him a job at the record label and stuff like this. It's, so it was just amazing. And I just, you know, can't believe how good Saturday, I mean, it was probably too good, probably stopped me from doing anything for 10 years, really. I was put on hold while I had a great time. So anyway, things were starting to slide a little bit, I guess. Numbers on Friday went down, and Saturday wasn't fantastic. And they had a new manager at the bar, and he wanted to fix the place up. Now, fixing the place up meant there was no place for people to pay to come in. But his idea was, nobody paid to come anymore. We're going to put a lot of couches in, do it up. It was really the end. So we said, we put a poster out, the end of the world as we know it, and Lizard Lounge was finished in 2001. It did have a little bit more life in it left. We came back and it did some free nights there. I think it kept going to about 2003 in the end, really. But one night I fainted and I never went back. And that was the end.
worn tire, slash and burn, return. Listen to yourself churn. Locking in uniform and book burning, blood letting. Every motive escalate, automotive center.